Men go and come, but the earth abides. A man reaches over the top of a rock ledge, and a snake strikes. He pulls his wounded hand away, stumbling back down the trail he'd been hiking in the woods. He's too far out to get help. He gropes his way back to his cabin in the hills and collapses on the bed. Consciousness comes and goes. It's been days, or weeks? Finally, though, his strength returns and he hikes down the mountain to the California he'd come from. But little of that California remains. In the blink of an eye, humanity has been reduced to a pitiful fraction of what it once was. The meager survivors of a great new plague. And that is how Earth Abides begins. And it serves as a transition point in science fiction from dystopias to apocalypses. From the 1930s to the early 50s, we had the great era of dystopias, culminating in Vonnegut's 1952 novel, Player Piano, and Bradbury's 1953 classic, Fahrenheit 451. These are dystopias driven by the fear of fascism, authoritarianism, and the almost unconscious relinquishing of freedoms that come with great wars. And for the most part, these novels were written by people who weren't traditionally science fiction authors, like Huxley or Orwell, using the trappings of science fiction, such as a future setting or advances in psychology, to send a warning about events they saw occurring in the present. And later, in the 60s, as we'll talk about in a few episodes down the line, we'll see the resurgence of dystopias, but this time driven by fears of societal decay. In between the two, though, we'll see a flood of apocalyptic novels. So how did science fiction move from things are gonna get bad to things are straight up gonna end? The answer's simple. The Cold War. In 1955, the Soviet Union tested their first hydrogen bomb, and it became clear to the world that for the first time in human history, we really did have the power to wipe everything out. Up until that moment, even after the horrors of Hiroshima and Nagasaki, fears were limited. At first by the fact that only one power in the world had nuclear technology, and then later by the fact that the USSR had access to only a limited amount of fission, not fusion weapons. But after the 1955 test, it was clear. If these two antagonistic superpowers went to war, there might be no going back. And in a few episodes, we're going to talk a lot about the books inspired by this new terror, this constant, omnipresent dread of annihilation that humanity had to live with every day. But today, we're going to talk about the book that stands at the inflection point between our obsession with dystopias and our fear of nuclear annihilation. That book is Earth Abides. Published in 1949, the book revolves around humankind nearly being wiped out not by atomics, but by plague. It brings into sci-fi the post-war question of whether an ever-increasing human population is truly sustainable. And it conjures visions of us as McClear's rat. A species so abundant and so consumptive that when the first outside disease hits, it rapidly becomes extinct. But perhaps more important to the history of sci-fi, it'll ask the question that's almost cliche in science fiction today, but was nearly unexplored at the time. The question of how to rebuild after a collapse. The author addresses this in three stages. The first is a survey of the collapse, as his main character travels across America observing what remains. Here's where we get all the staples of post-apocalyptica we all know so well. Siphoning gas, scavenging canned food, and sleeping in hotel suites, because you can. But it's here, too, that we see sci-fi first raise the question of how much of our knowledge will actually be applicable after the fall. And not just in a sense that if you were, say, a plastics engineer before everything fell apart, that knowledge won't be useful when the entire production chain that let us make plastics disappears, but in the larger sense that everything will simply be different. For instance, there's a great moment where the main character thinks about the millions of cattle in America. Will they devour so much of the plant life that sections of the United States are reduced to barren and unanchored plains of dust? Or will all this domesticated easy prey make the predator population explode to such a degree that for at least a few decades, the world is far more dangerous than the one our ancestors faced thousands of years ago? In the end, though, the main character returns to California and sees that without the vast, interconnected web of commerce and travel that held us together, those who remain have started to pull back into village life, which brings us to the second stage of rebuilding, creating a community. It's now 22 years later, and the first generation born after the collapse has started to grow up. The main character tries to start a school to teach these children, But they're not interested in the old things. Too much of our technology is too finicky, too unreliable to be of any use to them. Even reading and writing are starting to slip away as time spent hunting or fishing or scavenging proves more valuable. And it's here that Earth Abides challenges one of our modern notions. Most post-apocalyptic fiction says that education is the answer, that if we could just teach people the old knowledge, humanity would right itself. But Earth Abides presents us with a different idea. What if knowledge has to grow with a society? What if certain ideas are right for certain times, or for certain levels of development in other areas like politics or urban growth? What if the pure know-how, the science alone, isn't enough for us to accept or use it? Perhaps we can't just leap back into the world of today. Perhaps a slower path has to be accepted. Which leads us to the third part, embracing the collapse. The main character is now an old man, barely lucid, and he's given up on his dream to educate the youth. But now he sees something else. He sees hope in the primitive society that they've built. As the children, now adults, hunt game with primitive bows and fish with makeshift rods, he sees them working together without some of the racism or classism that haunted his time. And he realizes that, perhaps, this is a better foundation to start again. And sure, in time, when humanity is ready, they'll find the old books and the old devices and reemerge as a modern civilization. But this time, maybe, they'll do it right.